Welcome, my friends, to Winsloe United Church on beautiful Prince Edward Island. Thanks so much for tuning in and making us part of your worship experience for this week. Now, folks, when people look at you, they will see different things. When the people of this congregation look at me, they see their minister. When Faith looks at me, she sees her dad. And when my beautiful wife Ruth looks at me, she sees that buffoon that can never remember to take out the trash. But I want to ask you, when God looks at you, what does he see? In the eyes of God, what is important? And that, my friends, is what we're going to look at today. And so, I'm here, you're here, so let's go praise the Lord.
Beautiful day out there. My wife and my daughter, I was going to say that my wife has left me for an older man, but, well, she's gone to visit her father, so yes, so she has left me for an older man. Faith went down along with her, and, you know, every day I get these weepy phone calls from my daughter, Faith. She says, "Dad, I really miss you." And I say, "Oh, thanks very much, Faith. Can you make sure Grampy gets internet next time we come down?" "But it's only so I can email you, Dad." Oh, well. It's nice to be missed at least a little bit, I guess. If not, let us begin our morning of worship. It's a beautiful day out there, but in here, the light of Christ needs to shine.
Jesus Christ once said, "I am the light of the world. For those who follow me will never walk in darkness, but instead will walk in the light of life." And so, my friends, as the light of Christ begins to shine in the sanctuary to take away our darkness, so let the word of God echo forth for all to hear. God sees not as man sees, for man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord, he looks at the heart. And then the people of God will say together, Amen.
A few years back, Waylon Jennings, he wrote this song, "Too Dumb for New York, Too Ugly for L.A. And basically what he was saying in that song was, from coast to coast, people look at different things. They look at the outside and then presume what's on the inside. What our word today from the book of Samuel says is that the Lord, he doesn't look at these things that the people in this world seem to think are important. What the good Lord looks at is what's in our heart. And with that in mind, let us stand and sing as we're able our opening hymn, "Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee."
Our time for love.
Please be seated.
Christ, when he came to this world, he said, the good news of the gospel is, the good news of the gospel is that the kingdom of God is on hand. And he went and he preached that wherever he went. And if you look through the gospel, that was his main message. Behold, the kingdom of God is at hand. And then when he was teaching, when he was out preaching and teaching, he went from just saying that the kingdom of God is at hand to actually start talking about it a little bit more. And so he went on this mountain with the disciples and with thousands around and began to preach. And he spoke about the kingdom of God. And he started summing it up in these things that we call the Beatitudes, the beautiful attitudes that we can have. And he codified them, and they've been passed down from generation to generation to here today. And as that word from Samuel said, God looks at our heart. So let us today come together with those Beatitudes that speak to the condition of our heart. And let us come together as they did those many years, and let us say together,
blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are they who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. And blessed are they who are persecuted for the sake of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
And I'm going to add one last one. Blessed are they who forget to press the button on the clicker, for he shall be given by a congregation. And as we come together, it says the first one, blessed are the poor in spirit. What does that mean? The poor in spirit are the people who know that we've lived in this world, and try as we might, we just can't live up to the standards that we set for ourselves, that the world sets for us, that God sets for us, that we've tried and we failed, that we need help, and that we need to be forgiven. It says, blessed are they who mourn, who say, look, we've tried and we're sorry. We wish we could do better, but Lord, with your help, we know that we can. On this day, as we come to this place, the house of God, as we come in this place where God says, I look at your heart, as we come to this place at the end of a week, but at the beginning of a brand new week, let us come before our God now with our prayer confession, and let us pray together. And dear Lord, we spend so much time on outward appearances. We think nice-looking homes reflect happiness. We think new cars reflect success. We think physical beauty reflects goodness. And we think our job titles reflect importance. Yet you do not look at outward appearances. You look at our hearts, and on this day we ask you to cleanse our hearts and forgive our sins. Grant us grace to grow more and more in your likeness and image. Through Jesus Christ, the light of the world. Amen. And Lord Jesus, I now ask you to hear the confessions of all here who seek you, who may truly need you this day. Hear now our secret sins and shames that we can share with nobody else, but we know that we can share with you. Be assured this day the Lord has heard you. Be assured this day that the Lord has forgiven you. Thanks be to God. and amen. Jesus Christ says, I have come to take away the sins of this world. As we go from day to day, week to week, month to month, sometimes year to year, quite often we carry these burdens with us, and sometimes we carry the scars of past misdeeds that we've done ourselves, or past misdeeds that others have done, well, to us. Jesus Christ says, I see your hurt. I'm reaching out my hand. Grab my hand, and together we will walk to a brand new day. And I'll teach you to walk in a brand new way. Lord, on this day, my friends, Jesus Christ reaches out his hand to take yours, to touch you, and to bring you home. So let us stand and sing as we're able our hymn, He Touched Me. I have a little story for you here today, just a little one. It used to be in the United Church that if you were going to be a minister, sometime during your education, the United Church would take you and they'd place you in a church, usually very far from home. It was called an internship, but basically it was an apprenticeship. And you were sent out there so that you could learn the ropes under the guidance of a wise and kindly minister who, hopefully knew the ropes himself. Well, that's all well and good. One day it came my turn. And usually what they would do is, if you were in the east, they'd send you out west. If you were out west, they'd send you out east. For me, they took me and they put me right in the middle, right in Toronto. And if you're wondering, the NHL was on strike that year, so I didn't have to put up with any of that Leaf nonsense. Anyway, I was placed out there, and I was placed part-time at Donway Covenant United Church and part-time at North York General Hospital. That way, I could get the experience of leading worship and this kind of stuff, and also, get the experience of, dealing with people who are ill and, dealing with those kind of needs that they have as well. And I was placed there for 10 months, and when you went there, it was a short period of time, so Ruth and all the gang didn't come with me, it was just me. But I was over there for 10 months, and time was getting close. In fact, Ruth had already taken some time off, and she was coming out to drive home with me. And Ruth was coming in, well, I don't know, a day or two. And I had gotten back to the place where I was being billeted. I was staying with Ralph and Sigrid Angel. And we just sat down, we ate our meal. It was chicken and rice. And I was sitting back, and I was feeling rather full. And the phone rang. Oh, it was about 7:30, I guess. And the phone rang. And Sigrid went and said, J.D. She was from Venezuela or Argentina. J.D., phone is for you. Terrible accent, I know, but I'm trying my best here. So I went and I got the phone. It was Joan Silcock-Smith. She was the head chaplain at North York General Hospital. And so I picked up the phone. And I said, hello, Joan. She said, so where are you? Well, I kind of figured she knew since she called me, but she said, where are you? And I said, well, I'm here with the Angels. Well, why aren't you here? Well, I didn't know where here was, so I said, well, I don't know. And she said, well, we're having a goodbye party for you, and you're not here. And I said, well, nobody invited me. Well, there was a long, awkward pause, and I could hear that sound, you know, when someone's trying to muffle the phone, put their hand over the receiver so they can't hear, but they weren't doing a very good job. And I heard, which one of you told J.D. that about the party? And there was another long, awkward silence. And then she came back on and said, J.D., we're having a surprise party. We're having a goodbye party for you. I guess it was a surprise party. We're having a goodbye party for you here today. Would you like to come over? We have pie. And well, that's all I really needed to hear. And so I get my coat on and I bid goodbye to the Angels, and I said, you know, I'll be back in a little bit. And I get there, and, well, you know, I don't know how long it took for them to call and say, you know, where the heck are you? But by the time I got there, you know, a lot of the people had left. Somebody had eaten all the pie. Joan had put together a plate for me, and I stayed for a little bit and everything like that. But, you know, instead of being this great big party, it was, you know, a fairly subdued affair, at least at that point in time. And I don't know about you folks, but you know, in this busy life that we live, it's very easy to be forgotten. In the busyness of life, it's quite easy that someone gets overlooked, someone gets forgotten, somebody's light shines a bit brighter than yours, and they get the attention and you get nothing. As the old song goes, you know, she gets the gold mine, you get the shaft. Quite often in this world, that's the way it is. And yet Jesus said, God knows the sparrows, each and every one. Jesus said, God knows the numbers of hair on your head. Jesus said that God knows you even before you were born. And in our word for the day that we all said together, God said, I see you, and I see what's in your heart. And all those other things that people maybe overlook, I see, and I count you as precious. I see you, I know you, and I've sent my son to call you home. In the song that we sang, he touched me. That's what Jesus has come to do. Touch you. Make you home. Make you whole. Let you know that you are not forgotten. And one day, when it's your time, and not before, he'll be there to guide you home. And that's just a little message that I leave with you here today.
The good Lord has given us eyes to see, ears to hear, a heart to love, and a mouth to praise the Lord. He's given us a life and a love to share. Let us come before that God now with the gifts that only we can give. Our offering will now be accepted. We seek to give back to God a small measure of what we received. Let us also give back to God the prayer God gave to us to say together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Now last year, I did quite a number of sermons on Abraham. And this year, I decided I was going to talk about David. And you say, well, geez, you haven't talked about David yet. Well, it's hard to talk about David until you talk about Samuel and Saul, because they're the ones that kind of set everything up. But today, we are going to take a look at how David is first called. When Jesus went and, you know, he called Peter and James and John and you know, all of them, there was a story about how he went to them and called them, and he came. Today we're going to look at the calling of David and the anointing of a king. From 1 Samuel 16, 1 to 13, we hear, The Lord said to Samuel, "How long will you mourn for Saul, since I have rejected him as king over Israel? Fill your horn with oil and be on your way. I'm sending you to Jesse of Bethlehem, and I've chosen one of his sons to be king." But Samuel said, "How can I go? If Saul hears about it, he'll kill me." And the Lord said, "Take a heifer with you and say, 'I have come to sacrifice to the Lord.' Invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show you what to do. You are to anoint me, you are to anoint for me the one I indicate." And Samuel did what the Lord said. When he arrived at Bethlehem, the elders of the town trembled when they met him, and they asked, "Do you come in peace?" And Samuel replied, "Yes, I come in peace. I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Consecrate yourselves and come to the sacrifice with me." Then he consecrated Jesse and his sons and invited them to the sacrifice. When they arrived, Samuel saw Eliab, and he thought, "Surely the Lord's anointed stands here before the Lord." But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not consider his appearance or his height, for I have rejected him. The Lord does not look at the things people look at. People look at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart." Then Jesse called Adonijah, or something like that, and had him pass in front of Samuel. But Samuel said, "The Lord has not chosen this one either." Jesse then called Shammah, and he passed by, but Samuel said, "Nor has the Lord chosen this one." Jesse had 7 of his sons pass before Samuel, but Samuel said to him, "The Lord has not chosen these." So he asked Jesse, "Are these all the sons that you have?" "There is still the youngest," Jesse answered. "He is tending the sheep." And Samuel said, "Send for him. We will not sit down until he arrives." And so he sent for him and had him brought in. He was glowing with health and had a fine appearance and handsome features. Then the Lord said, "Rise and anoint him. This is the one." So Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the presence of his brothers. And from that day on, the Spirit of the Lord came powerfully upon David. And then Samuel went to Ramah. May God bless to us our reading and our interpretation of this God's holy word. Amen. old silver-bearded priest makes his way down a narrow trail on the ancient hillside of Israel. A king's abject failure lies behind him. Bethlehem lies before him, and anxiety brews within him. Farmers in the field notice his presence, and those who know his face whisper his name, and those who hear his name whispered turn to stare. What is this wise man doing in the middle of this nowhere place? Samuel, God's chosen priest, the judge, what is he doing here? When Israel needed a spiritual force, Samuel provided it. When Israel wanted a king, Samuel anointed one. Saul. Saul. At the very name, Samuel shakes his head. The people wanted a king, so now we have a king. The people wanted a leader, so now we have a scoundrel and a failure. Samuel glances from side to side, fearfully said that out loud. It was one of those things that you say in your head, but it really comes out your mouth. But as he looks around, no one has heard him except some crows. You can't be too careful during the reign of a king gone manic. Saul's heart is growing harder. His eyes are growing wilder. He isn't the king that he used to be. And in God's eyes, he's not a king anymore. And so the Lord spoke to Samuel. How long will you mourn for Saul, since I've rejected him as king over Israel? Fill your horn with oil and be on your way. I'm sending you to Jesse of Bethlehem. I have chosen one of his sons to be king. And so here Samuel is, walking the trail towards Bethlehem. A wise man looking in Bethlehem for a king. His stomach churns and his thought races. It's hazardous to anoint a new king when Israel already has one. But it's even more hazardous to live with no leader in such explosive times. The Philistines, they're here. Where they come from, no one really knows, but they're here now. They're warring, they're bloodthirsty people who use weapons made of this material that no one has ever heard of before. They call it iron. And it rips through shields as if they weren't there. The Philistines, they build cities. The Israelites huddle in tents. The Philistines use weapons of iron, and the Israelites defend with slings and arrows. The Philistines, they thunder in chariots pulled by war horses. And the Israelites have donkeys and farm tools and knives. Corruption within Israel, danger without, Saul floundering and failing. God needed to do something. And so here's Samuel, walking the trail towards Bethlehem, looking for a king in a sleepy village in the middle of nowhere. When Samuel enters Bethlehem, a hush comes over the village. Prophets don't come to Bethlehem. Has he come to smite someone? Is he trying to hide? And if he's trying to hide, who's going to come looking for him? And what kind of army are they going to bring? With great fear and trembling, the elders of the town come to him. Do you come in peace? And Samuel smiles, and their tensions immediately subside. Yes, I have come in peace, he says. I have come to sacrifice to the Lord, and would consider it a great honor if you would join me. And so the elders, they hurry off to prepare themselves. And as they do, Samuel grabs one. His name is Jesse. And he says, why don't you bring your sons along with you? I want to meet them. When Jesse arrives back, he brings his seven sons. They are impressive. And Samuel smiles. Surely the Lord's anointed stands here, he thinks. And one by one, Jesse brings forward them to meet Samuel. First, Eliab. He's the oldest, the first. He's big, he's strong, he's handsome. Surely this is the one. But then the Lord speaks to Samuel in the way the Lord does. Do not consider his appearance or his height, for I have rejected him. The Lord does not look at things that people look at. People look at the outward appearance, but the Lord, he looks at the heart. And so one by one, Jesse presents each of his sons, and one by one, the Lord rejects each and every one of them. Seven sons pass by, seven sons fail. How can this be? The Lord himself said that Jesse's sons will be the next king, but then it dawns on him. Jesse, are these all your sons? Well, there's David. He's the youngest. He's the runt of the litter. He's only 10. He's out tending the sheep. Send for him. We will not sit down until he arrives. And when he does, the Lord says to Samuel, this is the one. David will go on to establish and inhabit Jerusalem, the holy city of God. During his time, he'll be called warrior, minstrel, giant killer. He'll be called king. The greatest of the Psalms will flow from his pen. But today, on this day, he's not even included in a family meeting. What caused this? What caused David to be forgotten? And what caused the Lord to pick him? Well, today we're going to look at three things. And last week, I said the power of the Bible is not that it causes us to look at history, but it causes us to look at ourselves. Because what's happening with David? It's happening with us. So let's look at three things. What God sees, the rushing spirit, and a father who doesn't forget. So what does God see? You see, Samuel, he saw Eliab and he thought, surely the Lord's anointed stands here before the Lord. So what did Samuel see? Well, he saw Jesse's firstborn. You see, that was important because the firstborn son was considered special. They were considered special because they were supposed to be blessed by God. They were specially groomed from birth to be the head of the household, and when the father died, all the wealth of the family went to the firstborn son. Jesse was an elder in the tribe. He was an important man. He was a well-to-do merchant. And that means Eliab would have been groomed to have special training and grooming, something that a king would need. Also, we saw a big lad, a tall, imposing-looking man. And that's impressive. It's impressive to look at. You know, when the ladies all want someone who's dark, tall, dark, and handsome, what's the first thing they're looking at? Tall. But more than that, it's practical. It's practical because that was what was important in a king. You see, William Wallace, the Scottish knight, the man who was called the Guardian of Scotland, he was called that because, by all accounts, he was unstoppable in battle. Unstoppable in battle. In the museum over in Scotland, they have a sword. From the end of the hilt to the tip of the blade, the sword is this tall. Imagine that. A hunk of iron, a sword, this tall. How big was a man who had a sword that long? Well, scientists tell us that, you know, the average height of a person using a sword that long would be 6'8". And that's why he was unstoppable in battle. Big man, big sword. The average height back then was about 5'3", 5'4". Big man, big sword, big wins in battle. That's important for a king. That would be important for a king, especially a king that was going to have to contend with the Philistines. And so when Samuel looked at Eliab, Samuel was impressed. He was impressed by his appearance. He was impressed by his skills. He was impressed by his gifts. He was impressed by his competence. But what does God say? He says, "Don't consider his appearance or his height, for I've rejected him." The Lord does not look at those things that people look at. People look at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. That's what's important to God. What is in your heart? Your character. He says, "Samuel, physical appearance, beauty, brilliance, talent, education, success, grooming, wealth, all that in my eyes are inconsequential." Why? Because that is not who you really are. You can be a rotten poor person. You can be a rotten wealthy person. You can be a rotten ignorant person. You can be a rotten educated person. The money, the education, you know, your looks, that doesn't change who you are on the inside. It doesn't change your heart. In our society today, we are bombarded by images. Cecil B. DeMille, Steven Spielberg, they didn't have the movie-making technology that most of us have on our cell phones. And as such, we're bombarded with images of everything from people's cats to vacation spots to the meals that they're sitting down to eat at restaurants, to the great exploits of their grandkids. And as a result, you know, we're sitting there and we're taking it all in and we can't help but make comparisons to ourselves. How am I stacking up against these images that I see? In fact, studies have linked increased use of social media and images that are sent out. They've linked all that to increased depression, anxiety, lower self-esteem. Why? Because like Samuel, we're looking at all these external things. We're looking at people's beauty and appearance and brilliance and all this kind of stuff and say, how come I can't be like that? Why can't my grandkids be math wizards? My, you know, 2 + 2 = 5 for my kids. Why can't I go to restaurants and have these beautiful meals? I just go to McDonald's and, you know, one of the guys drop it on the floor and pick it up and give it to me. Why can't I wear, look, those beautiful clothes? Look at me, I'm wearing white after Labor Day. Why can't I be like that? And when we do these things, we are doing the exact opposite of what God does. When we do that, when we're looking at these things, we're looking at the exact opposite of what God looks at. We are holding as important the exact opposite of what God says is important. And we take a look at the miseries of this world, everything from war to oppression to political corruption to broken relationships. What's their cause? Lack of nice clothes? People not looking good enough? People singing off key? Bad vacation spots? Cats that don't perform? No. All these evils are a result of what's in people's hearts. Things like pride and selfishness and resentment and hate. Do not consider his height, for I have rejected him. The Lord does not look at the things that people look at. People look at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. So what is in the heart that God finds precious? What are the character traits that God looks at? What's important to God? Well, we all said them together at the beginning of the service. Blessed are the peacemakers. Blessed are the merciful. Blessed are they who mourn. Blessed are the poor in spirit. These are the character traits that God sees in our hearts. And he says, you're blessed if you have these. That's what God sees. The second is the rushing spirit. When looking at this passage, there's a tendency to think that the first seven sons came out, they were prayed before Samuel, but they all had some kind of significant character flaw. But when David came before God, you know, he had this, you know, heart of gold, he had this great character, he was well put together, and everybody would know that he was a great king. You know, he'd walk in and the angel would sing, hallelujah. That's what they all, you know, that's a tendency to think. But that's not quite true. Why do I say that? We see at the end of the passage. So Samuel took the horn of oil and he anointed him in the presence of his brothers. And from that day on, the Spirit of the Lord came powerfully upon David. How do you get godly character? Well, first you have to experience God. How do you get kingly character? First you have to meet the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. When we were saying those Beatitudes together, how many people out there would say, geez, look at that person. He's mourning. He's blessed. Look at that person who's poor in spirit, who's broken, who says he can't do it on his own. Most people call him a failure, but God, he says, this person's blessed. When you can't get there on your own. Before you can hold these things as important, first you have to hear and see God, know God, and see why they're important. How do you get godly character? Well, first you have to experience God. The Holy Spirit of God had to move on David and work in his life for years to develop this kingly character. From the time David was anointed by Samuel to the time that he was actually crowned king was a span of 32 years. So from this passage to the actually crowned king is going to take 32 years. And why is that? Quite simple. David wasn't ready yet. Samuel anointed a 10 or a 12-year-old boy when he anointed David in front of his father and his brothers. He wasn't ready to be king at 10 years old. He had to grow up. He had to mature physically and mentally, emotionally and spiritually. He had to learn how to operate a royal court. He had to learn to be a warrior and a leader. But most of all, most important of all, it would take that long for David to develop a godly character that, for all his faults, and folks, he had a whole lot of them, but for all his faults, he knew that he was poor in spirit. And when he realized that he had made a mistake, that he made a mess of things, that he, you know, fouled up, he knew that he could come to God and that God would set him on the right path again. Now, this would take time, but it was time that God provided so that David could learn all the lessons that he would need to learn to one day be the most influential leader of his day and the greatest king of Israel. God prepared David. And folks, God prepares us. And that's why it's important to come to church. That's why we come to church. That's why we say prayers. That's why we look at these Bible lessons. That's why we sing beautiful music together to get this message, to bring us closer to God, to become in the presence of God, in the presence of the King. That is how we get the godly character, that it gradually works in our lives. And you know, the Holy Spirit, it works in people differently, and I'm sure, you know, you'll talk to some people, you know, maybe in the Pentecostal church or something like that, to say, the Holy Spirit, you know, moved them, and it was powerful and all this other kind of stuff. And I'm not saying that they're lying, I'm just saying that has never been my experience. My experience has been a very gradual one. that's moved me along the road. And when I take a look back at the man I was to the man I am today, I can see that the movement has been there. But it has been there because I've been able to experience God in the church, and I've told many stories about that. And I'm sure the same is there for you. God prepares us. God prepares us every day for what will come tomorrow. And that's important for us to understand, because what God is doing through us today is preparing us for where God wants us to be. You know, maybe next week, next month, next year, 5, 10 years down the road, I don't know. That's what we often fail to understand. With the guidance of the Holy Spirit, our hearts and our character are developing and maturing. When God looks at your heart, what does he see? Well, I'm sure when he looks at your heart, you know, he sees part of you that's timid or anxious or afraid or selfish or cruel sometimes. But I'm sure he also sees someone who's honestly seeking his will and his way of doing things. You see someone who become wiser and closer to him. Someone becoming more like him, more like God. And that's what he will see if we continue that way. And if we continue that way, what will we see? Again, we said it together at the beginning of the service. Blessed are the pure of heart, for they shall see God. And finally, we see a father who doesn't forget. When Jesse brought his sons to Samuel, he brought them all, every one of them except one, David. Or as his father called him in the ancient Hebrew, the Harkaton. And for all of you who maybe skipped the ancient Hebrew class at school, that's translated into English as the runt. Hardly an endearing term. By whatever measure Jesse used to rank his sons, David was the least. In fact, he was ranked so low that he wasn't even brought. He was forgotten out in the field with the sheep. He was the least amongst men. He was the least amongst men, but he was considered the most precious by God. Folks, I don't know how you've been treated in this world. Not attractive enough to get a call on that Friday night. Maybe not talented enough to make the team. Maybe not smart enough to get into college. Maybe not skilled enough or experienced enough to get that job. Maybe not talented enough to win the race. And so your mother or father brags about your sister or your brother, but fails to mention you. Maybe you were overlooked. Maybe you were forgotten. Maybe they had a party in your name and forgot to give you a call. But I'll tell you this, you have not been forgotten by God. You have not been overlooked. Isaiah 49:15 says, "Can a woman forget her nursing child? Can she have no pity on the son to whom she gave birth? Even these may forget, but I will not forget you." And he hasn't. You see, there was another king that came from Bethlehem that a wise man found with the sheep and the animals. In fact, he was born in a manger. There was another king that came from Bethlehem who was anointed by the Holy Spirit and driven out into the wilderness, not to be hunted by Saul, but to be hunted by Satan. There was another king that came from Bethlehem who came not to save his people from the Philistines, but to save his people from death. And there was another king from Bethlehem who came not to rule over the kingdom of Israel, but to rule over the kingdom of God. There is another king who said, You are not here to serve me. I'm here to serve you. There was another king who came and he said, I am going to prepare a place for you. And when it's your turn, when it's your time, when you come to me, there is a place for you. For in my home there is many mansions, and there is one there for you. You may have not been the most famous of people here, but you are precious in my sight. My friends, the Lord Jesus Christ, he sees you. He wants to spend time with you. He wants to show you how to live in this world. And when it's your turn, and not before, he'll ask you to come and live in his. To which I can only say, thanks be to God. And amen. And Lord, now let's just bow our minds and hearts just for a quick moment in prayer. And let us pray. And loving God, as we gather in your midst here today, we want to thank you. We want to thank you that we have not been forgotten. We want to thank you for this beautiful day. And in this beautiful day, we have been able to come and spend some time with you and with one another. We want to thank you for the beautiful music we were able to hear and to sing together. We want to thank you for the lessons that have been recorded for us to hear. And we want to thank you that we can spend some time in the presence of the King and learning what is truly important in this world. And yes, you know, we like to have nice things. We like to have nice cars and nice jobs. We like to have, you know, our cupboard full of food so that we can have something to eat later on. But we know that none of this is as important as showing love to our friends and our neighbors and the people in our community. Lord, on this day, we want to thank you that slowly we're getting back to a world of normal. We want to thank you for the people who have done such great work to get us to this day, get us to this time. Whether it was, you know, Dr. Morrison and all the work that she's been able to put in, whether it's all those people who were able to make sure that the grocery store stayed open, those people who were able to deliver packages to us so that we could get carriage and letters, but also, you know, goods that we need for our household. We want to thank you for the people who, you know, spent some time making sure that we got our food or got the doctors, those people who spent time putting needles in arms. And we want to thank you that we're able to come and be here together today. Lord, as we seek to leave this place, we ask that you watch over us. We ask that you look deep into our hearts. And when there's a barrier there, we ask that your Spirit come and push it to fill our lives, to remove those barriers. And we want to thank you that no matter what we do in this life, that we are not forgotten, that you are active and working in our lives, and that the peace and the love and the joy of God is ours. On this day, O Lord, these are the prayers of your people. And on this day, O Lord, hear our prayers. Amen. Well, folks, we've pretty much come to the end of our time here together, and I want to thank you. I want to thank you for coming and being part of our time here today, because when you're here, truly we feel blessed. And when you're not, you're missed. Whenever you came to this place here today, whether it be by yourself or in a carload, please know that when you came here, you didn't come alone. When you leave here, you don't leave alone, for the Spirit of the living God goes with you. And it's my prayer for you that wherever you go, whatever you do, whatever situation you find yourself in, that you're always able to feel the power and the presence of God acting and working in your life, because he is there. You know the love of God in your lives. You know the peace of Christ in your hearts and in your homes and in your families. And now may the grace, the mercy, and the peace of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit abide with each and every one of you this day and forevermore. Amen and amen.
Well, my friends, we've pretty much come to the end of our time here together, and I want to thank you. I want to thank you for tuning in and making us part of your worship experience for this week. Now, folks, when God is looking at you, he sees your heart. When God is looking at you, he sees your character. How do you get godly character? Well, you can't have godly character until you first experience God. How do you get kingly character? Well, first, you have to experience the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. So you might be asking, where can I go to get in touch with God? Where can I go to experience the Holy Spirit? Well, one place is right here at Winsloe United Church. And so, my friends, if you've never been to church before, or if you haven't been to church for a long time, please consider this to be your personal invitation to come right here to Winsloe United Church. Get to know God. Get to know his family. Experience God. Allow the Holy Spirit to come into your life. And you'll be saying, JD, I'd like to. I really would. But I haven't got that second shot in the arm yet, and I'm kind of nervous. If that's the case, then please continue to tune in. And always remember, God loves you, and so do we. And so, my friends, until we meet again, and we shall meet again, stay safe, and may God bless you richly.